We are so thrilled that you have joined us for worship this morning at Trinity Presbyterian Church. We invite you with open hearts and open minds, come together as we worship God.
Today's scripture comes from Exodus 16, verses 1 to 5. The whole congregation of the Israelites set out from Elim, and Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then the Lord said to Moses, I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days.
The question, are you still good? Can you make something from the wreckage? Would you take this heart and make it whole again? Though the mountains may be moved into the sea,
Our gospel lesson today comes to us from the 12th chapter of Luke's gospel. Listen for the word of God. Someone in the crowd said to him, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me. But he said to him, Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you? And he said to them, Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, You fool, This very night, your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Within The Healer's Tree by Annie Heppenstall, one can find a story about the hazels of wisdom. She writes, "There's an ancient Irish legend of a wellspring surrounded by 9 hazel trees, which can sprout, blossom, and bear fruit within the same hour. The hazelnuts are full of wisdom, which disperses in the water beneath when they fall. If a person eats the nuts, they too will become wise. But if they catch and eat a salmon which live there, they will be the wisest of all." There was a bard called Finn who wished to have this gift for himself. He spent 7 years trying to catch the salmon and in the end succeeded. Handing the fish to his apprentice Fionn to cook, he went off to prepare himself for the transformation he was about to undergo. Meanwhile, the boy set to work, but burning his thumb on the roasting fish's flesh, he licked his skin and tasted the fat. When the boy brought the fish to his master, Finn could see by the look in Fionn's eyes that he had changed and that he must have eaten some of the fish. Rage as he might, there was nothing Finn could do. All wisdom had passed to his apprentice, who went on to become the leader of Fianna, great heroes of Irish myth. Seeking wisdom is an age-old pursuit, but not everybody has the same idea about what they're looking for, nor the same motives. Holy wisdom is a rare and slippery fish indeed. And through the dappled and rippling water of our perception, we often mistake her counterpart, what Paul calls the wisdom of the world, for the real thing. But we can still discover the holy wisdom for ourselves if we truly want to. God's spring, God's fountain of wisdom, is sourced from a deep and ceaseless love, unlike the inadequate wells that we dig for ourselves, cracked cisterns which cannot hold water. There in the glistening water of the pool, a fish swims, Christ who feeds us with himself, that we might truly live. Through him, the spring of water wells up in us, gushing up to eternal life, so that we can live truly in spirit and in truth. In this way, the source of all our words and actions will not be the dry cisterns of our own confusion, but God's unfathomable love. As we drink and are transformed by the wellspring of God's wisdom within, so may we transform the earth. Each of us channel healing and peace. So I'd like to say today that this message is really about wisdom. But actually, it's also about abundance. It's about having enough. If we can embrace God's boundless wisdom, we can move to a place not only perspective-wise, but wisdom-wise, where we can know the reminder that God provides enough. And that might actually look like abundance. The Old Testament lesson that we heard today is both about the grumbling and the grace and the tension that are created there. We understand that the Israelites have been wandering and struggling, but God's grace abounds in spite of their prevalent sin. This text asks us to remember that God gives people not necessarily what they ask or pray for, rather what they need. One commentary suggests that God's generous gift of manna not only serves to sustain the Israelites, but it confirms God's presence. God meets the Israelites' need for food by richly providing for them the bread of heaven. As Scott Hosey also notes, later God will teach God's adopted sons and daughters that this bread points to the bread that is God's word, that nourishes and sustains God's people their whole life. However, here we have a unique sign of God's glory that's awaiting them in the desert of all places. The manna and the quail is a reminder that Israel will find God's gifts for her, not only in the extraordinary, but in the ordinary. God's provision is, after all, never just in what's unusual. It's also in what flies around God's adopted sons and daughters, and even sometimes it lands right in the middle of their campfire. Terence Fretheim sees this as particularly instructive for Israel. But perhaps there's something for Exodus in the 21st century our readers to learn and know as well. When we limit God's involvement with us to what's miraculous, we look for God's care only in what we think of as extraordinary. And then we ignore God's provision in the gifts of each new day, the food that we grow or that we buy, and the health that we enjoy. We no longer see God as caring so deeply about us that God provides even the most mundane things that sustain us. We sometimes overlook the beauty and the simplicity in the enough that we've already been entrusted with. It might take a little effort for us to shift our paradigm to reflect an understanding of how really having enough might really be an abundance. Pastor Adam Hamilton writes, in 2007, a large area of Southern California was ravaged by wildfires, and nearly 1 million people were evacuated from their homes. He says, as I watched the tragedy unfold via the television news coverage, it struck me that this was a moment in which so many people were being forced to think about their relationship to material possessions. The words of Jesus echoed in my ears every time I saw another picture of the raging fires. One's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. So many people had very little notice that the fires were coming in their direction. One family was awakened in the middle of the night by a daughter, just in time to look out the back window and see the fire leap across the interstate and begin a rapid climb up the hillside to their home. They and thousands of others had minutes to grab everything they could take from their homes and flee. Time magazine's online edition asked the question, what did you save from the fire, of the people who were staying in the emergency shelter at Qualcomm Stadium? Andrew saved his pillow. Shervy saved her family pictures and her books. Angel saved the saxophone he had been learning to play. Karen saved her two cats and important documents. Michelle saved her Bible, purse, shoes, diploma, and cell phone. What would you save? Imagine a wildfire is headed toward your home and you have 10 minutes to grab all that you can and flee. What will you take with you? Natural disasters remind us that everything in this world is temporary. That is why I can say with Jesus, my life does not consist in the abundance of possession. I believe that. I believe it first because Jesus said it. I also believe it because I somehow know intuitively that it's true. These two texts challenge us to reflect on God's grace and generosity and provision. But equally as important, the abundance that we enjoy in our lives. How does that abundance translate into enough and empower us to fight the overwhelming pull for more than we have or more than we need? I pray that we can hear the words of Jesus challenging us to let go of the trappings of this world and strive for divine things instead, as we share lovingly with those around us to make the world a better place. May it be so today and always. Amen. Together as a people of God, using the affirmation of faith, let us together profess what we believe. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. In him, all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. All things that have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn of the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. Amen. And let us bring our hearts and minds to a time of prayer together as the household of God. Let us pray. Called to be ministers of reconciliation, welcome, compassion, and trust, we pray for all in need. We pray for all life, that our thanks and praise to you, Creator and God, can be seen in all that we do. We pray for the earth and all its creatures, sparrows and all birds, lilies of the fields and grasses large and small, waterways and mountain ridges, valleys filled with reeds, fish and mammals, insects and microbes, that each day we honor our dependence on your creation. We pray for the courage to live out your commandments graciously and without reservation. We pray for those chosen to govern peoples and nations, that they rule with wisdom to promote the welfare of their people and the courage to work toward justice for everyone. We lift up especially peacekeepers and diplomats, that where tensions threaten to destroy lives, calm may prevail. We pray for those who suffer any form of oppression, that their tormentors learn to fear God's will and follow God's love. We pray for all who are sick, those who are rebuilding after natural disasters, those who have no work or are underemployed, those who have lost hope, and all who need comfort for any reason. For those who have yearned to see God face to face, that they may receive eternal rest, we pray especially for families that are in mourning and struggling during this time. Gracious God, fill us with single-minded focus on you. Help us to see what is eternal in the present. Free us from worry so that we recognize your love. We pray in the name of the one who is the light of the world, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. And as we return to God, a portion of the blessing and generosity that God has bestowed on us, we take a moment to say thank you. Thank you for the countless ways you support the mission and the ministries of Trinity. We ask that you continue to give, and we are greatly appreciative.
Join me for the unison offertory prayer. For the breath of life, for a life that sees, for insight to understand, for courage to witness, we give thanks, gracious God. The signs of your presence are everywhere. Your light and love surround us. May this offering witness to your grace and peace. Grant your spirit as a transforming power among us that inspires and enables our service. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Go forth into the world in peace to love and serve the Lord, knowing that God has provided abundantly for you, which is more than enough. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.